why Wing Chun is a weapon system. And when we're breaching, to understand breaching, eventually you've got to understand how we use our weapons. Okay? So if we look at the most basic breaching concept, when we touch the breach, regardless of whether we go from this way and I'm going to engage from the wall, or whether I'm going to engage from the tan, that's a bridging position, right? So just because you're bridging doesn't mean that you're in range. It just means that I'm preoccupied with the bridge because there's going to be a weapon at the end of this bridge. If it was just kickboxing, then there's no reason why I should engage that. I can just duck and try to take an angle for the shot. So that's why there's a big difference between kickboxing and bridging. The only reason why we need to bridge is because there's something at the end, because there's a lethal weapon at the end of the hand. Otherwise, I bypass the hand. It wouldn't make a difference. I just walk into it, because why would I care if I walked into it? Because why? There's a weapon there. So when we look at it, when we try to explain how do you dissect that bridge, how do you influence that bridge, the only reason why I'm here, why does Rich doesn't Rich just let go of the bridge, because he's obviously got another hand. Why didn't he just let go? At the moment, I've got his center. I've got Gorm on his center, so I've got positive press on his center. But where's the hand going to? It's not just going anywhere. It's not chasing the hand. Because Rich just chased the hand, I'm exposed here. So that's why we understand we're doing this without the weapon. So when we're training, the weapon's going to be an extension of the hand. So we can just call this, I don't know, blade hand. So at the moment, so if I put the blade hand towards Rich and it's on his face, he's not going to move the hand out of the way. He can try and move my blade out of the way, but at the moment, because it's pressed onto his center, i.e. center of balance, if he hasn't got superior bridging skills over me, he's not going to be able to push my hand out of the way. He can try push. What happens when you push? I challenge him. But what happens is that my bridge or my blade goes towards his face. So what happens is that, that's why when we do the demonstrations, if we're doing it from a bridging perspective, he's actually stuck too, not because he wants to, he can just take his hand out of the way, but if he takes his hand out of the way, it's going straight to his face. That's why when we're bridging, it looks like I'm only showing it temporarily where the hand position is. It's because what you can't see is you can't see the energy going into him. Does that make sense? Similarly, if I went this side and he engages here, that's not doing anything to his hand to bring it out or anything like that. That's actually pinned on his actual center of his face here. My guard comes to this position to control my position, because I know that he's still got one more weapon here. So the first thing that happens is that if I'm going this way, I'm wary of that. I'm not wary of this particular blade, because I've already checked that with my wound. Okay, I'm worried about the other hand. So what does my other hand do? It blocks that path. It takes over the path that's over here, and what happens from here? That stays there, because that's on his center. I'm pinning his balance with that center, and I move to this position. Can you see? So when we're looking for a bridge, it doesn't matter whether I go this way with my blade. That was on his hand. He can try and move my hand out of the way, but if he hasn't got superior bridging skills, what's happened is that, not that he can't, but what have I done to his bridge to keep him there? So the first thing I've done is that I've got his center, but I've also taken up the bridge from the distortion. The tan opens up to distort the bridge. He hasn't got any power left in the bridge to move it out of the way. He could try, but he's not going to have any power. Why? I've taken the bridge out. But the hand is not just holding him here, it's actually on his center. What's it, not only is on his center, what drives the other hand? His center. So the moment he releases the hand, I'm going to go straight forward, and he's going to have to use, going to have to defend with the other hand, but then I've got a free hand. Can you see why, how we relate it back to weapons? So it's not until you actually bring out weapons, in 1 second, it's not until you actually hold one of them. Because it's bridging, this was an extension, you don't actually need the weapons at this stage. That's why I said when after a few years then we will be using it. But first, learn how to bridge first. Okay, so it's not a sword fight. It's going to be training at close combat with knives. So what happens, if I hit it from here, again, you're not on my center, but I'm on your center, so it will just go straight through. Can you see? But what happens is that he can try and move the hand out of the way, but he's not going to, because that's pinned onto him with the gong. Can you see why it looks like we're stuck on the bridge when we don't have the weapons? It's because it's going towards him. So what that happens, if he's got no bridging skill and I just touch his knife, it's going straight through. There's not a lot he can do about it, because at the moment, if I touch him slowly, I can bring that in. He can move. Now I'm moving slowly. That doesn't stop him from moving fast. But if I'm actually taken out that actual bridge, I do it slowly, he can move as fast as he wants, but he's not going to be able to go anywhere, because he cannot stop the knife going into him. And if it's obviously a knife, he's not going to just throw his knife away or take it away, because he's going to be stabbed. Does that make sense? So regardless of which one we use, coming from the Wu or from the Tang, it makes no difference. And when you pick up one of these, do you truly understand what bridging is? Of course, you can still use it for empty hand. But with Wing Chun, the only purpose of the bridging, why you learn it, is because of this. Back in the day, obviously, these days you would use it for, you know, whatever, obviously for empty hand. But it's not going to be as effective as this. Okay, so anything that goes like this, it's going to be slightly different when you're doing it with the blade. Okay, so what happens is that when we engage the bridge, it's identical. It's an extension of the bridge. So I can, if I can take out the bridge without the blade, what I'm doing is I'm just extending the energy to the end of the blade. So what happens is that if I touch the bridge, I know where his center is. I've got his center, I've got his gong. No difference is, I've just taken out his bridge. He knows that, because he can't press it into me, because he's challenging my bridge, but I can bring it into him. But when you do it at normal speed and power, it just goes through, because you're not interested in playing. But before that, what we're interested in is that forward transmission. Okay. So what we're interested in, how do we control the bridge? The bridge is going to be, once you have the weapon, you pick up a weapon, you've done it all already. So it's got a bridge back. Now just look at the components of the bridge. What are we trying to do with the bridge? Firstly, when we have a bridge, we have a structure, which means that I want to maintain a certain distance, only for a split second, because if I've got structure, I've got space, that means I've got time before I have to address what's at the end of the bridge. Okay, so that's why we don't want to come in there and cut ourselves short and then put the weapon straight towards us by bringing it into us at any point. Because obviously the first thing I do is that if I've got a structure and it's too close, I extend it so I can create the structure. If I can't get the structure straight on, because that gives me time. Okay, I'm not saying you can't just obviously practice it and go in. It depends on obviously your level of skill and then the actual situation itself. But once we have the tank, I create the structure and then I can bring it in. Why? Because I have to close down the gap. Because if I'm here, I can't reach. But there's no point, it's like, if I move here, he moves his bridge and stops me from moving that position here. Then it just means that I'm on the periphery, so I might have to make more movement. All he has to do is just turn on his center. So the first time I touch his hand here, he's not going to be able to follow me with the bridge to the side. Why? Because I've taken the bridge out. And why am I taking the bridge out? First, I'm on his center to make sure that I've actually got his center of balance. He's still got one more hand there, which is attached to his center. So what happens? If I take this out, he can try to turn and follow me, Rich, but he's not going to be able to if I tied it up. But don't forget, if he threw the first punch, it's not going to be so easy for him to turn this way. Even if he was waiting for me and I'm at the position and he wants to turn from here, if I break the bridge, he's not going to be able to follow me. It's got a weakened bridge, which now is the flanking. So you can see, so we've only got really the Tang and the Wu. Then I place the Wu from this position. If I've got the Wu from this position, but I can't control his center, then every time I move here, you're following me, Rich. So every time I follow me, and he's still got one more here. If I can't break this bridge or influence this bridge to influence his center, then I'm going to have to be very quick to get to this position. Because I don't really want to face it here, because I know what's going to happen. That's coming here, and I'm in this position. Okay, if you didn't have enough speed, you end up, no, it's not the end of the world, because I can still get in. But I would really want to be going away from the other hand as soon as I engage this hand. So what are the small parts or all the components of the bridging that helps me to get there? When he throws the punch, if I have this one here, the first thing that happens, because it's a spiral, it's already rolling his bridge to one side. But I'm not interested in rolling this bridge. Where am I rolling this bridge to? His center. Now the hand has gone past his center. Every component of my bridge is connected to, because I've got a connection point. So from the Kiu Sau, we've got a connection point. I'm not going to let go of this connection point. Now why should he still give me this arm here? He's got no choice, because what I've done, I pushed it into him, and it wouldn't stop me from pushing it into his face. So it's an involuntary action from him, because you're thinking, why don't you just pull it back? If you threw that hand and just pulled it back, it would be in his face. Sorry. But you can see why he wouldn't pull it back. So if he felt it, he'll keep it there. Not because he wants to, because he has no choice, because it's stuck onto his face. And if he lets go, it's just going to go straight into his face. Do you understand? So that's why some people look at, and when they look at the bridging, they're thinking, well, you can always take it away and hit the other hand. If he hits with the other hand, he has to release the tension in this first hand before he can punch him on the other hand, in which case it's going to go straight through. And that's a different concept as well than if you're doing kickboxing, because you're only after the punch and then you retract it. But if we've got a weapon, we're actually trying to chop him or stab him with the actual weapon. Can you see? So bridging is a totally different concept to kickboxing. That's why the timing is different as well. So coming back to here again with the Wu, you know we've been doing the Wu drills. We have to keep on doing it so that on first touch, you not only take out his center, you take out the bridge. Okay, so when it comes hand, we're here, I've got to be on his center. On his center, you want to distort the bridge because it's spinal. Okay, if he carries on and he throws the other punch, then you've got, then the other hand that's originally on the bridge has to do the woo for woo, because you have to have flow, in which case I'm in this position. If he didn't move forward, he didn't throw the other hand, and I'm in this position here, I have to trap him with the woo for position here. No, he can't go to the next position. So what happens, the foxhole is to subdue the position. Why is that a subdued position? You see how the foxhole has distorted that position. Now, even if he was to use strength in his hand to stop me from doing that, it's still going to work if he has intent to actually put that into me. And the reason why is because he cannot maintain power in his bridge if he's going forward with it. Because what happens, the first thing is the wound distorts it. When you get into the foxhole, he doesn't have much left here. You can try to react to it if you want to react to it. You still don't have much chance if he had the intent to it. Now this time, don't have the intent to go forward and then have the intent to play, you know, where you want to try maintain your position, okay? So it's almost like a dummy in the sense that he's not fully committed, okay? So what happens, if he's not fully committed, I can still take out his center, because the center's coming up this way. I've distorted that elbow here, which means that there's nothing stopping me. I'm holding center still from here to here to walk to his side. Because of this, the way his hand is distorted, I only have to push it down. There's not a lot he can do about stopping me from doing it, because my whole body is walking into a distorted bridge. Can you see? So I'll do that again. I just get normal speed. If it looks like this, he can't really do much when he's got a distorted hand. What was that? It was the foxhole. The foxhole means to subdue. It's capitulation, which means that I've got a weapon on him here. I've got my other weapon facing his other weapon. Now I've got an opening. This is why it's foxhole position, and hence this is the most powerful attacking bridge in Wing Chun, is the foxhole. Because what it does is it takes apart the other person's defense. Obviously it takes a few years to train. But can you see when we're doing the woo for woo, it's a continuous one. And then when we finally have enough training, then we put it to knife, it's exactly the same. Okay?
Can you just slow down the foot thing that you did?
Okay. So the foxhole, it literally doesn't work unless you use the woo first. So it's obviously woo for woo. So what happens is the woo is the work, is the actual woo has to have the spiral to set the distortion running. So you can't just put it here or you can't put it here. You have to go all the way to the shoulder position from the woo. That's putting pressure, spiral pressure on the elbow. When you have the foxhole here and you continue it, the foxhole is not a shape. It's an expression of the internal expression of movement. So what happens is that you lock in that elbow with the Fok Sau, which is why he can't push it forward and he can't pull it back, because it's locked in at this stage. It's locked in through tension, his own tension. It looks like he can pull it away, but if he does, he's coming back into it. Obviously it takes a bit of training, because you have to use gong and you have to lock into his center. So when I touch the hand, it's actually locked at that specific time. You can't actually move it away because I'm still on his center. And it's only wiped that hand left from there. Okay, so this is why we do the bridging. When we do it more, you end up sticking to the person. So that's why we have Loi Lo. I've got to retain you for a split second. Now you could just relax and go back. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that for every action, there's a reaction. So if you understand what's actually happening to you when someone locks you up in tension, the opposite is just completely wrecked, and then you're going to have to quickly jump back. Yes? Okay? So that's what I'm saying. So when we're doing this bridging, touch the hand here, the reason why he's locked in for that is because you've got everything on his center and you're pushing it to his center, with not by leaning into him, but because of gong. The other alternative is just to walk into the person, so using your body weight to pin the position. So he could let go, but if he relaxes the hand, it's only going to go into his face. Yes? Okay, so this again. So what's going to happen is that now he can use his full momentum to actually influence his position to get into a flank position. Okay, because from this position, you're not in range. So the point is to throw an attack from here, because you've wasted. If you throw an attack, you have an opening. So you have to form a position as a self-defense anyway. He has to attack you, but he has to be in range first. There's no point in doing anything until he steps into your range, which is why we don't see us extended bridges to that far. No, this is as far as your bridge goes. If you need to go any further, you step further. That means that you retain your structure going as well. Yes? Any questions?